In accordance with California Governor's Executive Order N-2920, this meeting is not physically open to the public. Council and staff are meeting via Zoom, and there are many ways for the public to watch and participate. Information on how to join the meeting using Zoom or a landline mobile phone, along with how to submit public comment during the meeting tonight, is available on our website, cityofcapitola.org, and on the published meeting agenda. The public can also live stream the meeting on our website. As always, this meeting is cablecast live on Charter Communications Cable TV Channel 8 and is being recorded to be rebroadcast on the following Wednesday at 8 a.m. and on Saturday following the first rebroadcast at 1 p.m. on Charter Channel 71 and Comcast Channel 25. Our technician tonight is Melissa. Thank you, Mayor Brooks.
Thank you, Chloe. If you can all please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you very much. Okay, so we're now going to move on to item two. This is a report out on closed session. I'll turn this over to our city attorney.
Good evening, Council and Mayor Brooks. We had a closed session earlier this evening on the item on the agenda, and direction was given to staff. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, now on to item three. This is for additional materials.
Yes, thank you, Mayor Brooks. There were several. One attachment for item 8B, the village banner item, and then there were eight public comment emails regarding item 8C. That is the parklet program update. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, and do we have any additions and revisions to our agenda this evening?
Staff has no changes to the agenda in this evening.
All right, now for item five, oral communications.
I don't believe we have any comments this evening from staff.
I feel like that's new. I just caught that. New way. Item six for staff and city council comments. We'll go ahead and begin with the staff.
I'm sorry. I think I led you astray. The oral communications is intended to be public comments. I think I got a bit confused there.
Oh, I'm so sorry. That's confused me as well, and I didn't catch that earlier when I was reviewing it, so that's my apology. We're going to go back to item five, and let me just open this up for oral communications. This is public comment for items not on tonight's agenda. If you'd like to make a comment on this or consent any of consent items, this is your opportunity to do so. If you'd like to send us an email now, you can email us at publiccomment@ci.capitola.ca.us. Or to speak, you can raise your hand now by clicking on reactions down below, and then clicking raise hand in your Zoom application. Or by dialing *9, or if you call them today, *9 on your landline or mobile phone. And our moderator will unmute you. You'll have up to 3 minutes to speak.
Mayor Brooks, I do not see anybody attendees with their hand raised, and I do not see any emails on this item.
All right. So now we'll go ahead and move on to item six then for staff and city council comments. We'll begin with staff.
And as I said earlier, this evening I don't think we have any comments for you. Nothing.
Great. Thank you so much. And now for council comments, and we'll begin with council member Bertrand.
Yeah, I have make an announcement, which I regret to make, but I am resigning from the area aging the council, and informed the city clerk to put a posting that we have an opening.
I'm sorry to hear that,
Councilmember
Chan. Thank you. And now for any other comments from council this evening? Councilmember Kaiser.
Thank you. The Commission on the Environment met last night, and we are continuing our discussions about gas powered leaf blowers. And I think soon there'll be some information coming to council to at least alert the public if they'd also like to sort of get in on the discussion or feelings as far as whether it's just leaf blowers or if there's other gas powered items that may be of issue within our town, along with a lot of to-go items that have been used at restaurants, obviously with a heavy to-go year. So we're sort of trying to streamline operation, whether is compostable the best way or are recyclable plastics the best way. So we're sort of trying to move in the direction to make it user-friendly, which is good. It's just seemingly a little complicated, but I'm an advocate for public outreach, and so anybody listening today, if you have thoughts or whatnot, please shoot it our way, and I'd love to hear from anybody that has insight and information on that, and I want to move forward with making us green, as green as we can be. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I'd also like to report that gosh, I think it was a year ago that our city was given a grant for tobacco prevention, and we finally got to meet with Andy Daly and some representatives from the health department is talking about next steps on how to utilize the grant and those dollars. So we're going to be partnering with the school district on that initiative. So more to come on that. Okay, any other council comments? Okay, we're going to now move on to item 7. This is all items listed under consent items will be enacted as one motion in the form listed below. There will be no discussion on these items prior to the council vote on the action unless members of the city council request that those items to be discussed for separate review. So can I have a motion to approve all consent items? Councilmember Beauchamp. Councilmember, you are muted.
Well, I'd like to make a comment about the meeting minutes of June the 24th, just for a correction.
For a quick correction, go ahead.
Yeah, quick correction. So it's noted that I talked about the Area Agency on Aging Master Plan, but I also wanted it to be agendized for a future City Council meeting. So that wasn't noted.
Thank you. Thank you, Councilmember Bertrand. I'll make that change.
And I'm getting better at reading lips, Councilmember Bertrand, but you muted him.
Yes, right. I'll move the consent agenda.
Okay, we have a first to approve the consent agenda, consent items with that amendment. Do we have a second?
Second.
Councilmember Kaiser, we have a first and a second. Can I have a roll call, please?
Yes. Councilmember Bertrand.
I agree.
Councilmember Kaiser.
Aye.
Councilmember Peterson is absent. Vice Mayor Story?
Aye.
Mayor Brooks?
Aye.
Thank you.
All right, this item passes. We're going to now move on to item 8, general government and public hearings. To item 8A, receive an update on pandemic response. I'll pass this over to staff. And it's your turn,
Jay. All right. Thank you. I'll be covering this one and I'll keep it relatively short, but I do have some slides to share this evening. We'll try to respect everyone's time because I know we have a very full agenda this evening. So this is 29 times I've had this on the agenda, interestingly enough. As you know, usually we take a look at what the case numbers have been doing nationally. I think you've seen reported in the news that we've seen an uptick started in late June, particularly in areas of the Midwest as well as in the South. Unfortunately, California hasn't been immune from that trend. This is what the cases have looked like in California over the last, over the pandemic. And you can see since right around the end of June, early July, cases have started to tick up much more significantly in the last several days. The surge started in LA, and it seems to have migrated up into Northern California as well. To remind everybody, the last time we looked at this, this is our local Santa Cruz County coronavirus dashboard. We had 47 active known cases back on June 9th, so about a month and a half ago. And as of today, we're up to 140. So unfortunately, we are seeing a little bit of a case surge here locally as well. Now, one of the things, take a look also at our update on the vaccination status. Overall, in the state, we're just over 60% of either had a first or a second dose, with 52.6% of the population fully vaccinated as of today. What's been in the news recently, and I think everyone I'm sure has heard about it, is the Delta variant of coronavirus. It's significantly more contagious. I heard some quotes from the director of the CDC today talking about it being one of the most contagious respiratory viruses that she's ever seen in her career. At this point, it's not clear whether or not it causes more severe illness. Some studies have suggested that it does. Some have suggested that it doesn't. It has been a variant of concern since May, and it's now the dominant strain in the U.S. I strongly suspect that 58% of new infections is probably not accurate anymore, and I think it's the vast majority of new infections at this point. The good news is that our vaccines today are very effective against the Delta variant. All the Johnson & Johnson, the Moderna, as well as the Pfizer vaccine. So it is not, at this point, shown to be evading our vaccines. I'm sure you've seen in the press that in LA, initially in earlier July, the health officer recommended masks for indoor settings, and then on the 16th has now required masks for everyone, regardless of vaccination settings in public indoor settings. Just this week, as again, I'm sure everyone heard, Santa Cruz County health officer, in coordination with other health officers in the Bay Area, is now recommending that all people do wear masks when they're indoors in crowded spaces, and is urging businesses to adopt universal masking requirements for customers. And they also indicated in that same statement that health officers for the counties that were all participating in the statement that they would be actively monitoring the cases and the hospitalization rates and potentially refining the recommendations and orders moving forward. In response to this, the city of Capitola has modified their lobby procedures, where previously people could self-attest to wearing a mask or not. They're now saying masks are just mandatory in the lobby. It's a little easier process for everybody to understand. Applies to both staff and to members of the public. And so that includes the three lobbies, police department, city hall, as well as the recreation department. So try to understand where we might be going. Let's go back. One of the things I did was I took a look at some other countries that have had more experience with the Delta variant. That would include both India and the UK. And one of the things that I picked up, and this is just in my own analysis of the data, is that in both cases, the surge from where the surge started to the peak, and you know, I don't know whether or not UK is really at the peak right now, their cases have just started to seemingly tail off here in the last couple days, so it may be that they are at their peak, but it was about 2 months. Is about what it took to get from sort of cases starting to rise to where the cases peaked out. The reason I have the UK up here is because the UK has a similar vaccination rate to the US and also had similar experiences where a relatively large percentage of the population already been exposed to the virus. So that's the bad news. And you can see that with the Delta variant that their cases in this period of time right now were almost as high as the winter peak. But then here's the good news, is that when you look at their hospitalization data, you can see that their hospitalization data was a factor of 4 or 5 times lower than it was during the winter peak. So clearly they're getting a lot of cases right now in the UK, but the good news is that the rate of hospitalization is significantly lower than it was during the winter surge. So whether or not that's indicative of what's gonna happen for us, I'm certainly not one who can say for any certainty, but I do know that in Northern California, we started seeing sort of this increase due to the Delta variant right around July 4th. So at this point, we're probably 2 to 3 weeks into the surge. So I think my own prediction would be that we can probably see another period of times, 6 weeks, something on that order before hopefully then we see cases going back down, unless there's a significant public health intervention. I'm only sharing this just to give my own sort of guess of where we're going, but it's just that. It's not, you know, it's nothing definitive, and it's not coming from a health officer. We've talked in the past about in-person meetings, and I just want to make sure we're on the same page, that at this point our plan is to have our first council meeting in person on October 14th. We will obviously continue to monitor what's happening with the case numbers, and if at the end of the day the governor extends the exemption to allow virtual meetings to take place later than that, I'm more than happy to work with the mayor and figure out the right time for us to go back in person. And with that, I'm available for questions.
Council members, questions? Vice Mayor
Stewart. Thank you, Mayor Brooks. Jamie, thanks for this update. You know, it is disconcerting that our active case numbers are going up and seem to be going up significantly. And I just wanted to ask you, I know you give us a weekly update on Fridays, and whether you could include the active case numbers as a part of your weekly update so that we can be monitoring it.
Absolutely.
All right. Yeah. Thank you.
Great suggestion, Vice Mayor Story. Any other questions? Okay. Let's go ahead and go to public comment now for this item. So, who'd like to make a comment, send an email now to publiccomment@ci.capitola.ca.us. Or to speak, please raise your hand now by clicking on reactions, then clicking raise hand in your Zoom application, or by dialing *9. Our moderator will unmute you. You will have up to 3 minutes to speak.
Mayor Brooks, I do not see anybody attendees with their hands raised on this item, and I do not see any emails.
Okay. So we'll bring this back to council for further deliberation and a vote. Vice Mayor Stewart.
Yeah, thank you once again, Mayor Brooks. I know that there's very few people that are actually listening in, but for those that are, you know, you've seen that this report tell us that the active number of cases are starting to build up. And I think it just emphasizes the need for everyone to get vaccinated and for us to continue our vigilance. So I hope that those of you that are listening will pass this on to all your family and friends, so that we can maybe once and for all get a control on this COVID pandemic. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments? Okay. I'd like to entertain a motion. Do we have a motion?
I can move that.
We have a first from council member Kaiser to approve the recommended action for item 8A, and a second from Vice Mayor Story. May I have a roll call, please?
Council member Bertrand.
I approve.
Council member Kaiser.
Aye.
Thank you. Councilmember Peterson is absent. Vice Mayor Story.
Aye.
Mayor Brooks.
Aye.
Thank you.
This item passes. We'll now move on to item 8B, consider the Capitola Village banner's design. Whose item is this?
Mayor Brooks, it's my item. I will be sharing my screen, if that's okay.
Great.
Okay, hope we see the screen okay. So this is the Capitola Village project, banner project, excuse me. Previous this year, the BIA proposed hanging banners along the Capitola Village lampposts. Some of the Capitola Village lampposts have rods attached to them that allow for banners to be hung. The City Council asked the Art and Cultural Commission to review that proposal. What the Art and Cultural Commission is doing is forming a subcommittee to work with the BIA on this project. The subcommittee and the BIA submitted proposals to, after working, to the Art and Cultural Commission. And earlier this month, the Art and Cultural Commission recommended that what we're going to see the pilot project proposal for the City Council. Project is basically two sides, two different banners, which I'll follow up with pictures. One will have artwork, and one will have information about that, you know, that you're in Capitola Village and that sort of thing. The artwork is by a single artist, Evelyn Jenkins Drew. It's either going to be, at this point, depending on what the council approves and what the best quality they can get as far as digital, three or four different art pieces and approximately 12 to 15 of these light posts throughout the village. Just so you kind of give you a scale, there are approximately 25 of these light posts that have this capability. The banners are 18 inches by 36 inches. The proposed cost of the banners will be split 50-50 between the BIA and the city. Basically, the City Art Fund will pay for the art banners, and the BIA will pay for the ones with the BIA information. The BIA will also purchase the necessary, whatever necessary hardware is needed to install these. So I'm going to go through kind of the proposal. I have four different art banners, but the left side, as we talked about, that'll be the BIA side, which is kind of talks about enjoying Capitola Village, has the website. This is one of the pieces of work by Ms. Drew. The next proposal, kind of a very similar thing. I think one of the things the Art and Cultural Commission liked was kind of the similar art throughout the village. It wasn't as complicated as some, you know, when you have 10 or 12 different things throughout. This was a consistent pattern, and it's by the same artist. The original proposal was thought to be, we'd have the words on one side, the art on the other. The BIA would like to be able to kind of swap those around to kind of help with the visual interest in the village. We don't think that is a major issue because there's not a lot of places in the village where it's nothing but street lamps. As you'll see in one of the pictures I have, there's trees in between these lamps, so it's not like it's you know, just a straight line of the banners. This is another one. This is one we were talking about. Maybe they're still trying to get the right digital copy of it. It's a little different, but it's still it's from the same artist. I believe it was a Begonia Festival poster at one time. It's possible I'm wrong, and maybe someone on the public could correct me. And this is the last one. But they all have this similar theme. You know, this beach. And so what I tried to do in the next couple slides is give an idea of what they would look like. So this is, believe it or not, to the right scale. Those bars you see, I don't know if you see across, they're 18 inches. And the banners would be 36 inches in this case. I tried to find, as we're talking about, you can see that from this location, you really can't see very many other light posts. So I went down the street, and this would be kind of this next block. So and you can see they are switched across. On the first one, the wording's on the outside, and on the next one, the wording's on the inside. So trying to find a representation of what it would look like. So this time, what our recommendation is to approve the Capitola Village banners as recommended by the Capitola Art and Cultural Commission in partnership with the Capitola Beach and Village Improvement Association, the BIA. And I am, at this point, available for any questions.
Thank you, Larry. Councilmember Kaiser.
Thanks. Thank you, Larry. It looks really cool. So we'll be able to have sort of each version of those banners at different points within the village? Is that sort of the idea, or are we picking one?
No, the idea would be either three or four of these, depending on if the council has a preference, or if they can get the right quality art with that, to make sure all four of them have the right quality art. It would either be three or four, and then be varied throughout the village. I do actually have kind of a first level map if you're interested. The proposal, the idea would be not to put these on the flagpoles right along the beach. This would be more along Capitol Ave and some on the Esplanade. I don't think they wanted to kind of obscure the view at along the ocean. So yeah. it would be a mix of all of these.
That's super cool. My only concern, I guess this is more of a comment, but one looks like it's a direct replica of Zelda's patio. So I would just maybe X-nay that one unless they would like to pay for it or want to put their tagline on it or something. But that's just my point of view. But thank you.
Councilmember Bertrand.
Yeah, Larry, I have a comment about one of the banners. Could you go back to the one that shows the begonia?
Just want to remind council that this is time for questions. We will come back for comments. I just want to entertain questions right now.
Oh, I do have a question. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you.
So with the begonias, I'd just like to point attention to the objects to the left of the begonias. What do you think those are? I'm trying to figure that out.
The two little fence posts?
Yeah, just want people to focus on that, and you've identified them as fence posts. I'll make a comment about them later.
I assume they're fence posts, excuse me. I don't know. For sure.
I believe they're projections on the roof that's below the hill.
Okay, I just want attention focused on that, and so we have two different interpretations. So I'll make my comments later.
Okay,
sorry for common question comments.
I do it all the time, don't worry. And I'm going to do it to Vice Mayor Story when he's the mayor, so. all right, so we're going to go to public comments, and then we'll come back for comments for council. So, public comment, if you'd like to make a comment, send an email now to publiccomment@ci.ca.us or to speak, please raise your hand. Or you can dial *9 if you call, or click on *9 if you called in. Larry, do we have any emails or anyone with their hands raised?
Yes, Mayor Brooks, I have two people with their hands raised. The first is Lori Hill.
Okay, Ms. Hill, you have 3 minutes.
Thank you, Council. I was the privileged Art and Cultural Commissioner to partner with the BIA in the development of this project. It is definitely a pilot project. The message here is we wanted to bring something to the Council that represented professional-looking work as well as something that met the BIA's interest. And so I was delighted to be a part of it. Karn Hanna was a real person with that. Also, Jeff Betancourt from PPD Multimedia worked really hard with us for nothing, for no compensation, to develop many, many mock-ups. So you had something to look at. The pieces of art are historical pieces of art. They're from the Chamber of Commerce's art and wine posters. Yes, there's a 1993 Begonia Festival poster in there. And in my interpretation, Jacques, those little things that you see in there are remnants of fence posts that used to be up there, you know, way back in the time. And I suspect that that's problematic. It may be something that can be erased, but I like respecting the art as it's presented, as it was originally developed, without changing it. And I also want to thank Larry for really synthesizing all the work that's gone into this. And I love that he was able to mock up what they look like on a fence post, or on a light post. So thank you very much for that, Larry, because I think that really helps with the vision.
Thank you, Ms. Bell. Any other? There's one other person, Larry?
Yes, Mayor Brooks, we have Alexander Peterson.
Okay, Alexander?
Thank you. I just wanted to say I really like the art, and I think it's really beautiful and would definitely look great downtown. And so since I'm here, I figured I would give my 2 cents. I believe that those are 1x4 dog-eared fence flaps, part of a fence, having worked at a lumber yard for a long time. Thank you.
Thank you for your input. Okay. That should give us some time for folks who wanted to email in, Larry.
Yes, let me check. I do not see any emails on this, Mayor Brooks.
Okay. Well, thank you for your comments. We're now going to bring this back to the council for further comments and deliberation and a vote. Councilmember Burchett. Councilmember Bertrand?
There we go. Mm-hmm. I shake, so it's hard to unmute me. Yeah, I hate to make this comment because it's probably going to seem weird, but maybe because the things have been on my mind lately. Those slats, it took me a while. I knew the perspective, and it didn't sit right because I didn't see any fence like that back before my time. But my initial thought was, why do we have tombstones in the picture? And it just made me think of tombstones. That was my first, maybe it was subliminal or whatever. And that was my first thought. And then I had to think about it a little bit later. Oh, the perspective, I know where it's from, but there's no fence there. So it just, it struck me as strange. So that was just my thoughts.
Thank you, Councilmember Bertrand. Any other comments from council? No? Okay. Oh, Vice Mayor Storrs.
Thank you. I did want to report out to the council that that the Arts Commission on July 13th unanimously approved, you know, the banners and the work of art. And I wanted to particularly thank Ms. Drew for creating such a attractive and, I think, visually appealing representation of Capitola. And the BIA and the Arts Commission and Lori Hill, you know, working collaboratively together to come up with some ultimate design. I think it's, you know, a last minute change was the alternating designs from when the Arts Commission looked at it, but I don't think that that's a particular issue. That may make it even more interesting. And considering whether they're fence posts or tombstones or roof projections, I think that's just part of the artist's rendition, and it's part of what creates interest and makes art interesting. Maybe people will talk about, as we have, what exactly those are. So I'm good with it and will support approving this project. Thank you.
Thank you, Vice Mayor Storrs. Any other comments? Councilmember Bertrand, your hand was still raised. Did you have further comments? Okay. Councilmember Kaiser.
Thank you. So I was just curious, are we picking the ones that we're, or are we approving certain ones today, or is this just a motion to move forward with the banners themselves and then we'll pick the appropriate ones, or
sorry.
No, go for it. Thank you.
Mayor Brooks, is okay. I think the motion would be to approve the project, and I think working, if, unless you had a dislike or a specific one you weren't interested in, they would move forward to see if they could get the right images of those, you know, for this, to basically make them so they're large enough and can be seen large enough. If they ended up with three, there'd probably be only 12 of the light pulse posts. If they end up with doing four, then there'd probably be 15. It would just be depending on, you know, making sure they had the right quality of the image to post up, unless, of course, there was one that the council, one or two that the council did not want, and then we move forward with that.
Cool. Yeah, I guess, I mean, I don't mean to beat a dead horse, but I would just say moving away from anything that looks specific to a business, unless they're going to participate. That's my only point. Otherwise, I love the art. I love the idea. Full send on that one. Thanks, guys.
Councilmember
Bertrand. Yeah, I like them all, except for the tombstones. And, you know, I think that poster would be, that banner would be great without those fence posts there. It may be historic, but it's not, I've been around here for 30 years or something, and it's not historic to me. I would have had it been around here for a long time for it to be historic. So, it just seems too weird to me. That was my first thought when I saw it, and, you know, I don't think I would be the only one who would have that thought. They'd be wondering, you know, why are those things on a banner depicting how fun it is to be here in Capitola? It's a morbid thought, I have to admit, but I felt uncomfortable saying it, but I decided to say it because if it was my initial thought, I don't think I would be the only one. So it's just to put it out there.
Thank you, Councilmember Bertrand. Can you flip the slides again so I can see the picture, please?
Can you see that okay?
Yes, thank you.
Yes, one second. This is a council meeting.
Can you move to the one that Councilmember Kaiser is projecting looks
like?
Right.
It's right there. Yeah, thank you very much.
No problem. Yeah. Have a nice evening. So I think the group did a fantastic job. They most definitely have come a long way since the last one we looked at, and I love that they hired an artist and it looked very complete. I love the coloring. I love the art. I can see what Councilmember Kaiser is alluding to. Larry or Vice Minister, were there any other options that were like on the cusp of the group being agreeable to that could take this one's place?
I don't remember other ones being presented. It was just at this point, I believe it was just these four. I know Mr. Rue does have other artwork, but I believe these were the four that were being presented. I don't recall. I'd have to go look to see if there were any other ones, but I do not believe so. I think these were the four that were presented.
So, council members, we can entertain a motion at this time on whether to move forward with, I think we've heard from everybody and insight. Do we have anyone who would like to make a motion?
Sure. I can make a motion for all four, if that's what everybody's interested in. That's fine with me.
So, council member Kaiser, I'm going to help you just a little bit on this one. Is your motion to approve the recommended action, which is to approve the Capitola Village banners as recommended by the Art and Cultural Commission in partnership with the village? That would include all four of them, I believe.
Thank you. That'd be great.
Okay, so we have a first to approve the recommended action as read on our agenda this evening. Do we have a second?
I'll second
We have a first and a second from Councilmember Bertrand. May I have a roll call, please?
Councilmember Bertrand.
I approve.
Councilmember Kaiser.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story.
Aye.
Mayor Brooks.
Aye. Okay, this item passes. We're now going to move on to item C. This is the Parkway Program Update. Katie, I see you getting on. Is this your item?
It is. Can you hear me okay?
I can. Nice to see you.
Okay, nice to see Yeah. Good evening, Mayor Brooks and Council.
Oh, I'm sorry. I have a hand raised from Councilmember Kaiser before we move forward.
Thank you. So sorry, guys. I have to recuse from this one. As I am an employee of Paradise Beach Grill, we participate in the Parklet program, and it would be a financial conflict. But good on you, and thanks for staying up. Thank you.
We'll see you when we're done with this. Thank you, Councilmember Kaiser. Okay, Katie, back to you.
Okay, thank you, Mayor Brooks, and thank you, City Council. Tonight, my presentation will be a joint effort with Director Jessberg, as this is a joint effort between planning and public works. I'll be bringing you an update on the proposed outdoor dining program. Some background for you, in response to the pandemic back in May of 2020, the City Council authorized the creation of temporary outdoor dining program. The program was originally set to expire on September 30th of 2020, and subsequently there were extensions approved first to May 31st of 2021, and then we revisited those deadlines due to the pandemic and extended it to September 7th of 2021, and that's the current date in which the temporary outdoor dining is due to expire. During the process of having the outdoor dining, the council did ask staff to move forward with a work program to consider a long-term dining deck program. We brought that to the council on June 24th, and we received direction on key program elements. I'm going to go over the direction that was provided at the last council meeting. In terms of an overall cap for the future outdoor dining program, the council directed staff that we should bring forth about 50% of the existing outdoor dining at approximately 25 spaces. The spaces should be limited so that they're within the frontage of the businesses, and to develop a method of allocating spaces to the interested businesses, and I'll dive into that deeper at a future slide. City Council also, in regards to the Parklet design, they allocated $10,000 for prototypes that can be administratively approved. And they also, the other direction provided was to require planning commission approval for any custom designs of outdoor dining decks in the future. In terms of fees, the permit fee would be set at zero. We at this time cannot provide any construction assistance to the businesses, and there would be a space rent of $3,400 per parking space per year with an annual CPI adjustment. In terms of the lease, a maximum of 3 years for the at the beginning of this new program, so it can be tested out and massaged as needed. And for the streets, it was to allow outdoor dining on all the streets in the village and on the sidewalks on Monterey Avenue and the wharf, where the sidewalk widths are appropriate, and to exclude Longway in the future. And also during that June meeting, the council asked staff to come back with more information on a few items, and that's what we're here tonight to provide. The first item was, how would the space be allocated between the different businesses? Second, we asked for clarity on Coastal Commission's recommendations for shared private and public use. Next, we have maintenance requirements for the to make sure they're maintained, safety, program timing, and then winterization. So I'm going to go through each of these points. In terms of how to allocate the parklets, with a maximum of 25 spaces, we thought it would be best to take these three steps. When we put together a program, there it would be much more well-defined, but just to give you a general idea of our what we're suggesting. So we'd open the application application for a period of 45 days with a required $500 deposit per space. And then after the 45 days, we'd see how many businesses are interested and how many spaces. If the total number of requests is less than 25, then we could award those spaces to the applicant. If the request exceeds the 25, then we would assign either one or two spaces for each applicant. And for the remaining spaces, we would hold a lottery and award those depending on which businesses were picked from the lottery. The next item you asked for additional information was that Coastal Commission recommendation for sharing private and public use. Originally, the Coastal Commission was asking that the dining decks, when business were closed, be made available for the public to enjoy. After that June City Council meeting, I dove deeper with the Coastal Commission, asked them to provide us with examples and the structure of how that would work. And in response to that, they said actually they do have agreements for all those out on the wharf. And because over time it's been a real monitoring and enforcement issue, they decided to retract that recommendation. So they're no longer, if we were to move forward with the program, going to ask for shared private public use of those dining decks. However, their recommendation is to reduce the number of displaced parking spaces, which on the slide you can see we're reducing that from 50 to 25. They also suggested to create a temporary authorization so that it can be reviewed and make sure that Coastal Access is maintained and see how the program is working. And you've responded to that with your 3-year cap for the initiation of this program. And the other recommendation of the Coastal Commission was to use funds from the outdoor dining to reinvest into Coastal Access. So that could take the form of putting money towards our shuttle program, beautifying our beach and parks along the coast, improving signs, adding bicycle racks, improving our sidewalks, and also maintaining our great parking lot behind City Hall. So that's something we believe we could work with. Right now, the city allocates over $800,000 in coastal access-related improvements, and Director Jetford will go over that in the next slide. But within our 25 spaces that we're proposing, that would bring in $85,000 to the city. If we were to consider allocating funds towards coastal access, our recommendation would be putting about half of that towards coastal access, which would of course contribute to that over the $800,000. And now I'll have Director Jetford. Thank you.
Good evening, Mayor Brooks and council members. So the question was raised where the $800,000 figure on the previous slide had come from regarding current expenditures for coastal access. So this is just, we put this together, it's an estimate, and it covers everything that we do along the beach and providing facilities for visitors to the coast. So it includes public works staffing at our daily trips in there to pick up trash, especially on weekends and during the summer. Clean building maintenance comes in. There are janitorial services, and they provide that service to the Esplanade restrooms. Hope services we hire to do litter removal and pickup during the week during the summers. We have maintenance and utility costs at Esplanade Park. If you think about the lagoon management plan, providing our beach is all part of improving the coastal access. Obviously, lifeguards, the shuttle, and wharf maintenance are also things that we spend money on to improve the coastal access. The last one is the parking lot and maintenance and debt service for the two parking lots behind City Hall. When we rebuilt the lower lot and relocated the mobile homes there, we incurred quite a bit of debt, and the debt service on those that are paid from just the general fund is about $133,000. So you see, an estimated $904,000 comes up pretty quickly here. We used the figure $800,000 plus just because these are estimates. So that's where that figure comes from. Next slide, please. So I'd like to then talk about outdoor dining maintenance. As we've seen with the existing program, having a maintenance standard in the new program and being able to enforce that is a big issue. There's been a lot of areas that have been neglected and or have dead plants, just not picked up, not kept in a tidy manner. So what we would propose is that we have the lease agreement will include a security deposit that requires the decks to be maintained, and lack of maintenance per the standards in the lease will first resulted in a courtesy notice, and then we have enforcement of penalties. And ultimately, if we can't get compliance with the maintenance that was required up to the levels we want, we would remove the carpet at the security, the owner's expense using the security deposit for payment. Next slide, please. And another big issue is safety right now. We had the water-filled barricades at the beginning for a long time. But the kind of standards that we're seeing now is these bollards and elevated decks, whether they're concrete slats or wood, planters and other barriers that are much more scenic and have aesthetic value in place of street bollards or street barricades and construction barricades. You can see this is one in City of Santa Cruz where they, in the direction the traffic goes in, they have the bollards there, the three bollards that are lined up, those are traffic rated barriers that will stop a car. They also incorporate bike racks, as you can see there, the hoop. I think including the bike racks is a transportation and a great benefit. If we're going to displace cars, let's provide bike racks, but I wouldn't consider them part of the safety features here. Next slide, please. So here's just some other pictures of barriers and options. You can see the one on the right is the water-filled type barrier. I think that's what we want to try to avoid. Not very scenic, it works in a temporary manner, but in the long-term type of development, we would like to see what you see on the other two pictures. A very scenic and nicely kept and maintained, area defined, and then incorporate the bollards and other safety features as we can. Next slide, please. Okay. Now I'm going to pass it back to Director Hurley.
Thank you. So next we'll talk about winterization options. As you've seen in our village, it seems that the portable propane heaters have been one of the most popular options. They can move around, keep different sizes of groups warm. There's a couple of fire pits in the village as well. And another option is fixed wall mount heaters. The trick with that is that they need to run electricity to the site, and on a more permanent basis, we might figure out an aesthetically pleasing way to run electricity, but there's trip hazard involved when it runs on the ground, so we haven't seen many of those. Also, with the portable propane heaters and fire pits, there's standards under the fire code that have to be maintained in terms of risk, and so you're not seeing tents throughout the village when there are portable propane heaters because those two in conflict with each other in terms of fire risk. Other winterization options are retractable awnings and triangular shade sails and umbrellas. These offer more of shade, not so much protection from the rain, but as I stated, the tents is not something we foresee coming forward as part of the prototype design due to that, just the fact of the fire safety when you're trying to stay warm. I wanted to provide you with an example of what prototype designs could look like. So Los Gatos has a great program. I think there were five restaurants that got together and actually funded prototype designs. Pizza My Heart was one of them, the owner that is also the owner within our village. So they came up with several prototype designs. I'm showing three of them this evening. And just wanted to show there were questions about, you know, can we add some variety within these designs? So in the design you're seeing here, you can see there are different shade options, one being umbrellas on the top, fabric sail shades on the bottom, and then also a retractable fabric shade in the middle. You'll also notice that there's different finishes on the exterior between the fencing material, the different types of planters that are proposed, and even the improvements along the ground, whether it's a wood deck or cement, those are things we'll be looking at and see what's best for the city of Capitola. And stormwater is always a concern for us in the village and making sure we design that correctly. So that's an example of the three of prototypes. And I also wanted to go over program timing. So as I mentioned earlier, our COVID-19 temporary use permits are set to expire on September 7th. Once they expire, all the temporary dining improvements will be removed from the village. In the meantime, we're currently working on a new ordinance and drafting a new ordinance. We expect the city to adopt an ordinance by the end of September. And then we'll go through the process of submitting to the Coastal Commission and having that certified. And we anticipate that in early 2022, most likely by January of 2022, we will have a certified program. The Coastal Commission has been very forthcoming on their providing recommendations on what would work for them. And it seems like our program is in alignment with what they're asking. And that would launch in February of 2022 if all goes smoothly. And one more topic for tonight is the temporary use permit and a request, possibility of extending the program. So they're due to expire on September 7th, and we plan that purposely anticipating the Art and Wine Festival on September 11th and 12th. In talking with Carrie Arnone of the Chamber of Commerce, she looked over the site layout for the village. I believe Carrie will be able to speak this evening. But because they scaled back the festival with fewer artists and food vendors, they are in support of allowing the existing outdoor dining throughout the village to continue through the festival. And so with that, we're asking that you consider tonight extending the outdoor dining through September 13th. You know, there's been a lot of issues with employment and being able to provide services due to the pandemic, and something that the Chamber has run into is not being able to rent enough tables or any tables for food vending, and they're also only bringing in 3 food trucks this year, so the amount of food will be much more limited. And so trying to support our local businesses and allow them to provide more dining is why the Chamber of Commerce is asking for this to be extended, so it'll benefit both the local businesses as well as the Chamber. Staff's recommendation tonight is to receive our report and direct staff to extend the COVID-19 temporary outdoor dining through September 13th. And that concludes my presentation, and I'm available for any questions.
Thanks, Katie. I do have a real quick question for you. Have any of the other businesses reached out to even further the September 13th extension? I've seen some of them shutter for outdoor dining, but I'm curious if there's been a request to extend it even further past this deadline. And if you could also offer a reminder of why we set the September as our cutoff date from the beginning, that would be helpful for me.
Okay. So we chose the September date to accommodate the Art and Wine Festival and make sure that we cleared out the streets before the Art and Wine Festival. And so now we're asking to extend it beyond the Art and Wine Festival because it would be an asset to the festival and provide additional seating for guests. In terms of have I received any requests from any of the businesses? I do tend to speak with a lot of the businesses throughout the village regularly, and I would say there's definitely interest in a long-term program. I've heard a mix of feedback. I think some of the restaurants along the Esplanade are ready to pull. A couple of them have mentioned they're ready to remove it before the Art and Wine Festival. They were prepared to do so. On San Jose Avenue, it seemed there was more interest for possibly continuing it further, but nothing official has been given to me. And then also English Ales has also expressed wanting to keep their outdoor dining as long as they possibly could.
I'm gonna jump in. There was two other reasons that we also set the deadline in September. One is that the outdoor dining was authorized through the emergency orders, the state of emergency that the city is in. And you may remember that we were a little bit concerned about going out at the end of the year beyond when maybe the state of California's emergency orders were going to expire. And then secondarily, the Coastal Commission was also relying on those same emergency orders. So we were trying to sync it up with Art and Wine because it was sounding originally like it was going to conflict with Art and Wine. And also cognizant of the fact that the emergency authorization may or may not really be there come the end of September. Obviously, that could change moving forward, but I think that was some of the background on the date that we had before.
Okay.
Councilmember
Bertrand.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, I have a couple of questions. So I was interested in the $800,000. Thank you, Steve, for expanding on that. The cost for the wharf maintenance, is that normal maintenance, or are you factoring in what we do periodically to, like a time average to fix the pilings and stuff?
Councilmember Kirkin, no, I did not factor in the capital cost we spent on the wharf, to be honest with you. It was a quick grab of our kind of our annual expenditures out on the wharf for utilities and maintenance costs.
So I think I like your presentation. It should definitely remind everyone how much we spend to maintain the village and keep it attractive to the visitors. One other issue that I'm interested in, and I talked to you, Katie, about this, is the bike spots for bike parking. I'm just trying to get an idea of what's the Coastal Commission think about that? You mentioned that might help in terms of public access. I'm just trying to get a sense of what the thought process. I totally agree. I mean, with the idea of not having to take cars down here instead of bringing your bike, I think it's a great idea. So what are they telling you?
So that is one of their recommended mitigation measures, is to include bicycle parking within the dining deck areas, like you saw in the Lublos example. So I think with it, we have to figure out how that would work within our village and the village design, but at a minimum, it could be on the, you know, right on the parking space next to the dining deck that you saw in the Lublos design.
Okay, yeah. As you know, we received a letter from a member of the public that we all know, and so I think his concern was the placement of the bike rack so that it wouldn't be a hazard to cars pulling in and out and maybe being damaged. So I'm sure you're thinking about things like that because you haven't even come up with your design yet. But thanks.
Vice Mayor.
Thank you, Mayor Brooks. I had three questions. One concerning the Coastal Commission and their expectation that we provide greater coastal access. And I was kind of unclear about what they're going to require, since this is replacement money. This is the rental for the parklet is not new money that we could just direct to a restricted purpose. But are they asking that these funds or the funds in this amount be restricted for coastal access? So are they going to be expecting more than that?
So the Coastal Commission is asking that when we put together our programs, that a portion of the funds that are taken in for rent be restricted towards coastal improvements. But we could utilize it now that we, you know, currently with the number of $800,000, $900,000, we could show that, you know, we're already spending that. It doesn't have to go beyond that. It's the, you know, just the, those funds, the $45,000 that we'll be taking in, will go towards, you know, those improvements we're already spending money on. So they're not asking for it in addition to.
So they just want us to restrict it or label it something else.
Correct.
And then spend it our discretion. Okay. Steve, I was wanting to also ask about the concrete slabs that are assume are part of one of the prototype designs, or since these are potentially temporary, is that going to be problematic if they need to be removed? And we also got some input that those concrete slabs in the street would impede drainage. And so what's your view on that?
So first on the drainage, similar to the wooden decks, they are poured so that they don't go up to the curb face. There's about an 8 to 12 inch gap between the curb face and the concrete slab itself that allows the water to continue to flow along the curb line where it normally flows. Water coming off the street will flow underneath and flow around the edges of the concrete slab. So I think there are provisions for stormwater with that. As far as being able to remove them, my take on them is that they are poured on top of the street. There's a barrier, a cloth barrier most likely, or a plastic barrier that's put between the street and the concrete slab. When it comes time to remove it, it's not going to be removed in one piece. It'll be removed and probably demolished as part of the removal, but that can be done without damaging the street, which is really what we're after. It's also possible to build them in sections so that if there is a need to get under the road at a certain point, we can do that too and be able to move those. So in some regards, they're pretty equal to the wood deck and probably provide a longer lasting surface depending on how long they're in place.
Okay, thank you. And now going to the Art and Wine the chamber asking that that the parklets on San Jose and as I understand it on the Esplanade be removed for the Art and Wine Festival. I guess a couple of questions are one, are the businesses on the Esplanade, are they aware that the parklets would be removed? I know that the business on San Jose is aware because we've heard from them. But speaking to that, I wonder why these two locations, and particularly on San Jose, were they asking that those parklets be removed?
So Vice Mayor Story, I think this will be a great question for Kerry when we open the public hearing, but I can give you some of the history of this. At first, the chamber was still actively taking in applications from artists when we went through the village setup in preparation for the city council meeting and making determinations of where they would need outdoor dining removed. Through this process and hearing from the restaurant, the chamber has modified their decision and no longer is requesting that the restaurant be removed or the outdoor dining be removed. But I think this would be better answered during the public comment period by the chamber directly. But it has been an evolving process of looking at their site layout, and originally it was for fire and circulation purposes, but I think they've been able to modify their layout and they've taken out, I believe, 22 booths they've removed from past years to accommodate all of the outdoor dining to stay in place.
But just to be 100% clear, when the staff report went out, it was consistent with what the chamber was requesting at the time, was that the outdoor dining come off the Esplanade in San Jose. Subsequent to the staff report coming out, the chamber is now saying everything that's there today should stay. Staff has changed our recommendation to sync it up with the Chamber of Commerce. So the request in front of you this evening is to keep the outdoor dining where it exists today, leave it on San Jose, as we've heard from the public, through Art and Wine.
Okay.
Hope that helps.
Yeah, that helps a great deal. Yeah, thank you.
Any other questions before we move on to public comment? Okay, seeing none, we'll now open this to public comment for this item. If you'd like to make a comment, send an email now to publiccomment@ci.capitola.ca.us or to speak, just
raise your hand now by clicking on reactions, then clicking raise hand in your Zoom application, or by dialing *9 on your landline or mobile phone if you've called in today. A moderator will unmute you and you'll have up to 3 minutes to speak. Thank you, Chloe, for turning on the timer or getting it ready.
No problem.
Larry.
So, Mayor Brooks, I have a few people to speak. First person, and I apologize if I pronounce it wrong, but Dharmesh Patel.
Yes, can you hear me?
We can hear you.
Okay, great. Yeah, Dharmesh Patel, one of the owners of the Capitola Hotel. Wanted to just remind council that when we started this process of putting in outdoor dining, you know, we were asked, you know, obviously being probably the most affected business operationally by losing all the parking across from our hotel, because that's where our customers park. We have sent a parking permit for guests to park in exactly those locations that were taken out. We were allowed to move those permits to have guests park anywhere in the village, but again, from an operational and from a temporary basis, that was fine. If this becomes something more permanent, it does become an operational issue because of convenience, safety, ability to unload, load for hotel guests. You know, the parking across from the hotel itself was key. We obviously wanted to be good citizens within the village and support the restaurants, and we did. If this becomes a permanent, it's going to be longer term, we need to be involved in this process because we will still be a very affected business by this, because we have to be able to provide some sort of parking and loading zone for our hotel guests. Guests are, you know, paying 12% DOT, which is a you know, important thing to our budget, as well as they're in the village, they're staying there, they're eating there, they're shopping at the shops. They're an important part of our economy in the village. So I just want to make sure that the, you know, council remembers that, as well as we haven't been contacted for any input in this process yet, and I hope somebody will reach out to us and make sure that we do are allowed to have input in this process. We want to encourage the three spots that are the only three metered spots that are between Stockton and San Jose are right in front of our hotel. When we started this process, there were discussions that maybe we would create a dedicated hotel loading zone like they have in almost any village setting for hotels, one spot, because the loading zone that does exist is just north of us, and that is pretty much used by the restaurants and for delivery, so never available for hotel guests. If a hotel guest does park in one of them, one person has to stay in the car, otherwise they will be ticketed. That's not feasible if you have a guest coming in by themselves who needs to check in. So, you know, our thought would be to have a dedicated loading zone in front of our hotel, and we are happy to leave the other two spots that are in front of our hotel, so at least we have some sort of dedicated parking for the hotel. Yeah, hopefully that is something that will be considered and talked about amongst yourselves and the public. Thank you.
Mayor Brooks, we have Carrie Arnone.
Hi, this is my first time speaking to the council, so this is kind of exciting for me. The Capitola Soquel Chamber, we'd like to retract our previous request that the outdoor dining parklets be removed prior to the Capitola Art and Wine Festival. In the last week, we have revisited the festival layout, and out of respect for our village businesses still utilizing the parklets, we have eliminated approximately 25 booth spaces to accommodate the parklets currently in place. We support the existing outdoor dining parklets and ask for your consideration to extend the outdoor dining through the festival. Thank you.
Yeah.
Mayor Brooks, we have Josh Fisher.
Hello there, check one, check one. Can you hear me?
We can hear you.
Hello, friends. First of all, thank you very much to Public Works and to City Council and to the Planning Department for helping us get this off the ground and essentially helping save a lot of businesses down here. We would also like you to consider we being Council Mercantile and my own business, Left Coast Office Works on San Jose Avenue. We'd love for the parties to continue till the end of the year, preferably. However, happy if they would continue through the Art and Wine Festival, as I think it would help the festival, just like I said, adding some seating and helping with food. So far, so good. I think the permanent idea could be really good too, and we're definitely interested. I can't speak for everyone, but I am assuming that Caruso's and the wine bar also would like to continue, and we do appreciate everything that you guys have done to help us out, fast track permits and other things like that. So yeah, just we're in support is what I'm trying to say, and thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, do you have any emails for public comment?
Mayor Brooks, I do not see any emails on this item, and I do not see any other attendees wishing to speak.
Okay, great. All right, so we'll bring this back to council for further comments and a vote. And this is just a reminder, we've already voted on this item back in June for just the outline. So we are just approving, we're just receiving the report on additional details that we requested at the last meeting to come forward today, and to just extend the COVID temporary use permits allowing for outdoor dining on in those areas to after the Art and Wine. So that is the recommended action. Any other comments from council, or would someone like to entertain a motion? Vice Mayor Story.
I just wanted to thank everyone for giving their input. I especially want to thank the chamber for retracting their request to incorporate all the businesses into Art and Wine Festival, and having all the parklets be able to continue. I will say I have kind of an inkling that, you know, we may end up needing to extend this even further into the fall, and so I don't think any of us think that that's necessarily going to be the end of the temporary parklets. But that's for a later day. I would just also like to, following that of Mr. Patel's request, ask the staff to make sure that the Capitola Hotel is involved in the parklet design configurations, and soon we could fit in a dedicated voting zone for that particular business. And with that, I'd like to move the staff recommendation.
Okay, we have a first to approve item C, the parklet program update and staff recommended action. Do we have a second? Okay. I'm going to go ahead and second just for a verbal. I saw your son, Councilmember Chan, but I just for sake of so you can hear me, I'll go ahead and second that just in case our city attorney wants an actual verbal. So we have a first and a second. May I have a roll call, please?
Councilmember Bertrand.
I agree.
Thank you. Vice Mayor Story.
Aye.
And Mayor Brooks.
Aye. Okay, this item passes. Thank you, Council. Thank you, staff, for all your hard work on this. I'm excited to see what comes, what it becomes. Okay, item D, authorize the advertisement of construction bids for the work rehabilitation program, phase one. Mr. Jesper, this is your item.
Mayor and Council, let me share my screen here. I assume you can now see this, so I will continue. The item before you tonight is a wharf rehabilitation project, phase one. Kind of project has many names, so this is the one I'm going to stick with at this point. Some background on the item. In May, the council provided direction to the Public Works Department to proceed with a piling repair project. In that meeting in May, we kind of talked about the funding and schedule for the project, both the larger project, the wharf stabilization and resiliency project, and that's not going to be able to go to construction until probably next spring. So we have direction to move forward with repairing some pilings that are in need of repair heading into this winter. This project will repair the steel pilings at the end of the wharf. It's recommended this time. We've been watching these piles for quite a while. We had anticipated the larger project being going forward now or earlier than now, but due to permitting and funding issues, we have not been able to get it off the ground yet, but we can't get the smaller project off the ground. And we'll also include repair of a structure underneath the restaurant where it's necessary, where we lost two piles. The structure's not compromised now, but it does need to be reinforced in that area. So, scary picture I showed you last time, same one. You can see the steel piles at the end where they have corroded out. They're still structurally sound, but the amount of corrosion there is back to the point where we feel it is necessary to repair them at this time. So looking at the schedule and funding, the plan specification estimate for the project has been completed, and the project is ready to advertise. We will hold a bid opening on August 25th. We will return to the council on September 9th to award a contract if it comes in higher than our estimate. And construction, I'm anticipating, would be starting in November 2021. We will try and expedite that as quickly as we can. There's some materials that will need to be fabricated to move forward with this. So, and by the time we get all the contracts signed, I think November is a good target date for this. The estimated cost of construction is $482,500. Funding will be primarily through the state grant we have for the larger wharf project. We've talked with the state, and they are more than willing to pay for the construction elements of this project, since it's included in the larger project. Measure F funding is being utilized. I think we've paid for the engineering that's gone to date up to this. We may be able to recoup some of that from the state grant also, but it'll include that as a funding source for this project. So you can see there's definitely enough money to move forward with this project. Recommendation tonight is to approve the plan specification estimate for the construction of the wharf rehabilitation project phase one and authorize Public Works to advertise for bids. That concludes my report, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Duffberg. Vice Mayor Story.
Yeah, thank you again, Mayor Brooks, and thank you, Steve. You know, I wanted to ask about backfilling the sleeves with slurry. Somehow I'd gotten into my head that it would be reinforced concrete. Slurry, is that going to be have the strength and an integrity to hold up for the duration that we expect?
Yeah, because they have an outer sleeve that is either going to be fiberglass or high-density polyethylene plastic that is corrosion-resistant and wear-resistant. The concrete, these piles are in compression as opposed to tension, and so the concrete is very good at resisting that, and structurally, they're sufficient. That's the method we did reuse to repair under the hoist on the pier that failed in 2020 when we lost the piles under that, and it was major falling. We used the same repair method for that, and those were just backfilled with concrete. So steel is not required because of the outer casing that we're putting in.
So most of the resilience is actually in the sleeve casing.
Well, it's definitely a combination because they are in compression, like I was saying. It's not, we're pulling on them, we're just loading them up, I guess.
Okay. My next question, Steve, was I know you said you hope to start about November 2021. will you be able to finish by what day or by the winter?
Yeah, I mean, I wish I was 2 months earlier in getting this to you guys, but we're not. They won't be able to continue and work. Obviously, they won't be able to work during storm events or anything like that if those were occurred during construction. Typically, our larger storms are in January, February, and we should be completed by then. I think it's a 4 to 6 week window to complete the project. We'll work with the contractor to make sure we get it done.
Okay, good. Thank you.
Councilmember Bertrand.
Thank you very much. I was going to ask any questions. Steve, you and I talked earlier, so I didn't have anything. But you mentioned, I looked at these pictures of the pilings. They just looked horrible. And then you just recently mentioned that they're still structurally sound. Can you help me understand that? They look like miserable, like they're suffering. And
so they are supporting the load. Structurally, they are capable. There's enough steel there. And, you know, like I've been saying, they're in compression. They are supporting the loads that are putting along them right now. The problem we face is that they're hit at this point. They potentially could fail. The engineers don't think so. They think they're sound, but they agree that it's time to repair them. They've had holes in them for several years now. And what I mean by the structurally sound is they're holding up the warp. They're quite capable in their current condition of holding up the warp.
Okay, you brought up my other question was the lateral assault, because traditionally during storms we've had logs banging against the piers, and that's a lateral assault.
Right. And most of the corrosion is up near the top, as you can see, that you saw in the pictures, where you're not going to get too much of the log. Log tees are much lower, but it's time to repair. I'm not going to try and overspeak on their condition.
No, I want to thank you for pushing this along. It's just really important that we get this done, and so I appreciate your diligence in this regard. Thank you.
Okay, any other questions? We will now move on to public comment for this item. If you'd like to make a comment, send an email now to publiccomment@ci.capitola.us. Or to speak, please raise your hand now by clicking on reactions, then clicking raise hand in your Zoom application. Or if you've called in today, you can dial *9. Our moderator will unmute you, and you will have 3 minutes to speak on this item.
Mayor Brooks, I do not see any attendees asking to speak on this item, and I don't have any emails on this item.
Okay, so we'll bring this back to council for further comments and a vote.
I'd like to move staff recommendation as written in the staff report.
Okay.
I'll second.
A first from Vice Mayor Story and a second from Councilmember Bertrand. May I have a roll call, please?
Councilmember Bertrand.
I agree.
Councilmember Kaiser.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story.
Aye.
Mayor Brooks.
Aye. Okay, this item passes. We'll now move on to item 8E. This is a library lease ordinance, the first reading. Whose item is this?
Mayor Brooks, this is my item. Give me a second here. I will share my screen. How does that look?
That's great.
So this item before you this evening is library lease ordinance first reading. It's a little bit of an odd item, so I will spend some time kind of explaining what we're doing this evening. But first, some background. In 2004, the city entered an agreement, a contract with the county that required the city to build a library and then required us to lease it to the county for 99 years. In exchange for that, the county is going to assume all responsibility to maintain the library and also to make sure that the library staff at the same levels service hours as the Aptos branch. So interestingly enough, Government Code 37380 authorizes cities entering into leases that are longer than 50 years and up to 99 years, provided that the city has authorizes the lease by ordinance and also has publicly advertised the opportunity, competitive opportunity, to bid on the property's lease. And then the city council has to offer the lease offer, authorize the bidder who offers the city the greatest economic return. Now, clearly this bit of code was written around context, imagining commercial leases. And in fact, in another section of code, in the civil code, there's an exemption for leases for parks. But we were unable to locate any sort of exemption for this for a public building like a library. So, rather than try to fight it, the city basically has just worked towards compliance with this. So what we've done is we issued the public notice inviting bids. We received one bid from the county that was consistent with the terms of the 2004 contract, where they said that they agreed to staff the library and maintain the building for 99 years. And then we've also worked to prepare a draft lease that is attached to this ordinance at this point. It's not the final lease. We still have to finalize that with all the different parties, that is included as well. So I hope that makes a little bit of sense about what we're doing this evening. This is really sort of setting the stage so we can ultimately approve the 99-year lease in an upcoming meeting. The draft lease, which includes some key terms at this point, these are the key terms I don't see really changing at this point as we move forward. There are probably some legal language that will be revised, but I think these are the larger policy questions. And the key things are that the county is assuming all maintenance and assures the office, the hours and the staffing levels of the Aptos branch. The county is already doing this, in fact, because we took it off the property, off the city's property property insurance rolls this year, and the county picked it up and is now insuring the building moving forward. The city may step in and complete maintenance if in an emergency or if we notify the county or their lease subleasees and library JPA that the facility isn't being properly maintained, and the lease calls for us to be reimbursed in that situation. This lease also allows the city to use the property to secure debt. Often when cities borrow money, we have to basically, it's not really collateral, but it's sort of like collateral, but the cities have to identify a piece of property that is tied to debt. And we actually don't have very many pieces of property that qualify for that, so this is actually a valuable thing for the city, for sure. And the lease doesn't cover the tot lot. The tot lot has always been kind of a city park, and so we would continue to maintain it. And it wasn't part of the original agreement that they would maintain playgrounds adjacent to the library. A question came up about the city's rights to use the facility moving forward, and so this has actually been a topic that's been a topic of discussion at the library board. All the cities, we all have the same kinds of questions about our facilities and how we get access to them. And so recently, policy 315 was updated, and it includes specific provisions that allow library partners, and it was expressly added, this term library partners, so that cities could enter agreements with the JPA, it's authorized in this policy, and then gain after hours access to the facility. The policy also outlines that the government, other government agencies have a priority to access the facility and outline how other people can reserve and utilize the spaces. The policy is being actively used, and in fact, I just talked to the interim library director today, and they're looking at a potential revision to this policy coming up for taking it to the Library Advisory Commission shortly that would actually make the study rooms available on a day-of basis, because they found that the study rooms were often used by youth and individuals, and it didn't make sense to be able to sort of reserve it far out into the future. So I just wanted to provide that information because I know that question could come up, as you know, we just built this building, we don't, now we're handing it over to somebody else, which was kind of the deal when we got into this with the county. So with that, our recommendation this evening is two parts. One is that determined that the bid was received from Santa Cruz County to lease the property at 2005 Wharf Road, which is the library, and to operate and maintain the Capitola Library with a rent payment of $1 a year offers the greatest economic return to the city. And then second is approve the first reading and waive reading of text of the proposed uncodified ordinance allowing the city to enter into a lease with a term in excess of 55 years and authorizing the lease to Santa Cruz County from Capitola Library. And with that, I'm available for questions.
Great, that was the fastest reading of a staff recommendation I've ever heard.
I didn't bother, everyone's face was over the side, so I actually couldn't read it, so I was kind of trying to wait.
Okay, we're going to go to questions for council members. Council member for Tran.
Yeah, I did have a question about public use, and of course, Nikki had already talked about trying to work with library staff for children's programs. So I think you nailed it. This policy 315 does that, and I'm glad you were part of that discussion as part of the governing board. So I have two questions then, not three. So I'd like to know how the governing board works in terms of policy issues that we may feel need to be addressed that affect the city of Capitola. And that might be great for the public to hear. Maybe other members of this board know that, but I don't. And the other thing is the deck considered part of the library, or is that considered part of the park in terms of maintenance?
All right, I'll take your questions in reverse order. So the deck is part of the library, so it's included in the overall library maintenance, so it would not be a city responsibility to maintain. The second question is, how does the library board, how does the library board make policy decisions? So about 5 years ago, the library board shifted from one that was comprised of some city council members and some members of the public to being the city managers. So the library board is comprised of myself and my peers, the other cities, as well as the county chief administrative officer. And so we are called upon to ultimately make the final decisions. We've been leaning very hard on the Library Advisory Commission. You'll recall that we made an appointment to the Library Advisory Commission. We recently appointed former council member Michael Termini to the Library Advisory Commission. So they review all the library policies and budget as well, and then make a recommendation to the board. And in general, I found that the Library Advisory Commission's recommendations have almost always been approved without change, or if the changes, often we would make a comment and send it back, and then they would sort of tweak the recommendation. So that's how the library board today makes policy decisions.
So thank you. So if we had any concerns as the city council, we would go through you.
Absolutely. And you know, there are times in the past, thankfully we haven't really experienced that recently, where libraries have had to make very difficult decisions about service hours and potentially closing branches. And in situations like that, I would be putting an item on the council's agenda to update the council and then also seek feedback on, you know, how the city of Capitola was going to participate on the library board.
Yeah, I have one follow-up question, if I may, Mayor. So you carry hours, and in the agreement, we're sort of tied to the Aptos branch. Can you talk a little bit about that? We're going to be quite bigger than, we are quite bigger than them, and they'll be closed pretty soon because of renovations. Why are we tied to the Aptos branch?
So I wasn't part of the negotiations in 2004, but I can tell you a couple of things is that, so that it was tied in 2004 in the contract that the city adopted with the county. My assumption is that at that point, the Aptos branch was open and functional in the nearest branch to Capitola. Keep in mind the Aptos branch is closing and it's going to be, it's increasing in size, and so it will be relatively similar size to the Capitola branch when all is said and done.
Okay.
And interestingly enough, if I remember correctly, the Capitola branch is tied to the Aptos branch, and then the Scotts Valley branch is tied to the Live Oak and the Aptos branch. So I think through various contracts, Scotts Valley, Capitola, Live Oak, and Aptos are actually all kind of intertwined in terms of various agreements about hours. Some agreements that the city is not party to. But I think that all of them are sort of intended to be operated as kind of, you know, not main, but regional libraries, and with consistent staffing and patterns.
Thank you.
Vice Mayor Stark.
Thank you. Jamie, I was wondering if we have identified our lease administrator in section 18.3.
Yeah, that is still blank. I believe that would be the city manager. Potentially, we may designate the public works director. I don't think we figured that out yet.
Okay. My other question is, usually in leases, I'm used to seeing prevailing party or attorney's fees clause. And there's not one in this lease. And I was just wondering why. Maybe that's the question for our city attorney.
I think that's exactly right. Sam?
I don't really have a great answer to that. I don't really have a great answer to that. I don't see them in all leases. I see them in some, but not all. It's often hard to recover attorney's fees from a public agency. So because this lease is two public agencies, it could be unlikely that even if there is an attorney's fee provision, that it just hasn't been included. They're less commonly included in leases between two public agencies, and even between a public agency and a private party. It doesn't necessarily serve the public agency to include them. So they may be less common now than they used to be.
Okay, well, it's good to know. I mean, I'm just, the county center is the Norton County Council, fully funded all the time. So we did get into this field. Without an attorney's fee clause, I think we would be at a disadvantage. But I'll leave that up to you guys to figure out the best course for the benefit of the city. Thank you.
Okay, any other questions? Okay, so we'll go ahead and move this to open public comment. If you'd like to make a comment, send an email now to publiccomments@ti.capitola.ca.us. Or to speak, please raise your hand now by clicking on reactions, then clicking raise hand in your Zoom application, or by dialing *9 on your phone. Our moderator will unmute you, and you'll have up to 3 minutes to speak. Larry?
Mayor Brooks, I do not see any attendees wishing or with their hands raised on this item, and I do not see any emails on this item.
Okay, so we'll bring this back to council for further comment and a vote. Vice Mayor Story, your hand is raised.
I didn't intend it to be raised, but since it was raised, I'll just make a comment that this is a wonderful milestone along the path of a great project, one for the public. I really appreciate everyone who's worked so hard in getting us to this point. And with that, I'll move the staff recommendations one and two as stated in the staff report. Thank you.
All right. We have a first, Councilmember Bertrand.
Yeah, I'll make the second, but I'd like to make a comment, which I forgot to make earlier, if I may.
Please.
Yeah. So I think, Jamie, I brought up before my concern about public use of the parking lot with the library and adjacent businesses that have used that. And you told me that you're working on this, and that I don't know if Sam, our attorney, could have some comments on that, because I think we do have some options in terms of the reality that there is issues in that regard.
So I'll turn it over to you real quick, Zach and Sam. I think the issue is for the public or people who aren't aware is that for a long time that parking lot was overbuilt and has been used by the adjacent businesses and other folks to store cars. And so we're definitely concerned about it now that it's a bit smaller and the library is going to be used so heavily, and what our options might be moving forward to make sure that that lot is properly regulated. And Sam, I know we talked. I'll turn it over to you on what our options might be.
Well, Councilmember Trend, Jamie and I did talk about this question earlier today, and I think the Public Works Director would be able to enforce any current parking regulations. I don't think that the lease needs to address this issue.
Yeah, no, I don't think the lease needs to be, I'm learning about leases between private, I'm just saying public entities, I have to admit. But, you know, I just want the public to know that we are addressing this, and you brought up Steve, I don't know if he has a comment about this, but we do have the leverage to do this legally. That's my main concern.
So if I may, I would just add that we do have 4 signs in the existing lot. That are clearly stated that the parking is for library use only, and it does reference the appropriate code section in the municipal code so that it is enforceable by the police department. So we have taken that steps, and I've worked with library staff because I shared the concerns of the nearby businesses utilizing this parking lot like they did in the past. And so far, so good, we haven't had that issue, but if they do develop, myself and the police department will work on enforcement of that, of the signs that are up.
Thank you very much. And with that, I'd like to make a second on the motion.
Okay, we have a first and a second to adopt item 8E, number 1 and number 2 of staff recommendation. May I have a roll call, please?
Councilmember Bertrand.
I approve.
Councilmember Kaiser.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story.
Aye.
Mayor Brooks.
Aye. Okay, this item passes. We're now going to move to item 8F, consider bail schedule for fiscal year 2021-22.
Yes, Mayor Brooks, I'll be presenting, so just give me one moment, please. Can you see me? No. You can hear me. Here I am. Okay. And are you seeing the notes or the presentation?
We see the presentation on straight
code. Okay, great. Thank you very much. Okay, so this is just gonna be a quick presentation. Thank you, Mayor Brooks and Council. To go over the recommended updates to our bail schedule for 2021. So we'll get started. You know, what is the bail schedule? Just the basics here. This is our official list of the fines associated with any violations locally. So that would be violations of Capitola's municipal code. And as our code grows and changes, and as council adopts ordinances, our bail schedule should reflect those changes. And just a note that the base bail amounts listed don't necessarily reflect the entire fine that a violator will end up paying, because there's many fines and fees added by the county court system. So our base bail is really what's intended to come back to the city from that total. So here's just an example that's already reflected in our current bail schedule. For example, we have the section of code 9.28010, vehicle operations, basically stating that you shouldn't drive your car on the beach unless you're allowed to, like you're an emergency vehicle, etc. So reflected in our code, you see here we have our code section, the violation description, no vehicles on the beach, and then the base bail amount. If one were to drive on the beach, there would be a base bail of $100. So you have your code and then the bail. They're kind of like a couple in that way. So this year, our additions are regarding the recently adopted ordinance 1031, which updated the code section about tobacco retailer licenses. So we have our specific section listed here, 5.38020, and the violation description is tobacco retailer licenses required. So there's the base bail for that, and then also the selling of flavored tobacco being prohibited. So we have the base bail for those two violations. And really there's just one more specific change about ordinance 1037, which updated a different code section, section 12.64, the sidewalk vending program. In that case, the violation would be basically vending without a permit, as permits are now required. And the base bail for that is split. You'll see there's a first offense and a second offense. So kind of like an escalating situation, starting at $50 and then going up to $100. And I just wanted to mention, you'll notice in the packet there, the exhibit to the resolution is the full bail schedule. There were a few changes just reflecting the recent adoption of Chapter 17 zoning. Some of the numbering had to be changed so that the correct violations and code numbers are all together and that they line up correctly. So there's just some kind of administrative changes there. So I'm available for any questions, but really the action tonight before you would be to adopt the proposed resolution in the packet, which repeals resolution number 4149, which is the past bail schedule, and adopts the new bail schedule. Thank you.
Okay, questions from city council members? Councilmember Bertrand.
Yeah, Mayor, can I ask questions not only about the three that are being proposed, but there's other fines. I just have some questions about two other fines.
I think it would be appropriate to ask those questions from the agenda.
Okay, great. So, Chloe, how was the amount of $100 set for selling of flavored tobacco? How was that amount arrived at?
That, basically, we propose an amount and it kind of goes between our office, the police department, and then the city manager, and also by doing analysis of other local jurisdictions and similar violations that are already in our bail schedule to kind of keep things all on the same track. So that's how that was determined and really how all of the fees are determined, or the base bail are determined.
Oh, okay. So that answers my question. I'll reserve a comment for later. I had a question about the cannabis processing and cultivation prohibited.
Okay.
Yeah, I thought I could grow cannabis. Does that apply here, or is this for like a company doing cultivation? I thought I was allowed under California state proposition that was passed by the public to grow 6 or 8 plants. I have no clue, but I thought that was allowed.
You're correct, it is. This is for a violation. That violation, that's the bail schedule you cited, was for growing outside of the guidelines of the state of California.
Okay, thank you very much. This is sort of tongue-in-cheek, but and this is for our city attorney. I thought First Amendment, or the right to express yourself, allowed you to go to the beach, for instance, nude. So we have a fine for that. I just had to ask. I'm not up on First Amendment in terms of expressing yourself, but I thought that was something that is allowed.
I didn't mean to cut my video there. I was trying to unmute myself. It can still be regulated. I will admit I'm not quite sure how to respond to that. The city is still regulated and imposed fines. If my guess is it's on a stretch of beach where it is regulated, and that would be the fine for the violation.
Okay. Yeah. I know in San Francisco there's certain places I know I could go to if I want to be at a new beach, and there's other places that obviously are family oriented, and the two do not mix. Okay. Well, thank you.
Doc, I love your questions. Those are perfect.
I mean, looking through all these fines, I mean, you know, you could make comments about all of them, but.
That's great. Okay. No other questions, we'll go to public comment. If you'd like to make a comment, send an email now to publiccomment@ci.capitola.ca.us. Or to speak, please raise your hand now by clicking on reactions and clicking raise hand in your Zoom application, or by dialing *9 on your phone. Our moderator will unmute you and you will have a 3 minutes to speak.
Mayor Brooks, I do not see any attendees asking to speak on this item, and I do not have any email messages.
is on this item.
Okay, we'll bring this back to council for further comments and a vote. Councilmember Bertrand.
Yeah, my comment about the fine for selling flavored tobacco, I remember when we passed the ordinance on that, and there was a lot of emails thanking us for taking that stance. And I know in general, many communities feel this way because it's such a, it leads kids into smoking tobacco. I think that's the issue. So the reason why I asked about $100 is I do think it should be larger, and this is when you could stop something from happening at an early stage for a kid that could affect their health and life for the rest of the years that they live on this planet. So I would like to have some discussion about whether we think $100 is enough. You know, if a merchant is selling this tobacco, they all know what it's doing. You know, as an adult, you've made that choice. But a kid, there's a lot of peer pressure. They have no idea what the health issues are. And heck, it tastes good. It doesn't bother me. How is it considered bad if I like the taste and feeling, fine about it? So it's a lot of things, for youth, they're just not informed about these issues. So I would like the discussion a bit more about that. If people feel this is sufficient, I kind of like it, maybe $300 or something. I do not want our public merchants even thinking about selling this to you.
If I may, Councilmember Bertrand, when we passed this ordinance, I asked a similar question. I think it was a year.
You were very concerned about it.
And the response, and I know our chief was there when we asked the question to public health, when I brought it up, and I was surprised that they agreed not to raise it because it was a cost, and Jamie, I see you turned your camera on, it was a cost that everyone was following throughout the county. So this was an ordinance that was passed that each city throughout the county was adopting at the time, and it seemed to just kind of be the status quo, that everyone was agreeable that this would be the rate. And if we're following the standard, this would just be the standard rate of the set standard sales rate. So it didn't seem, we didn't get much pushback from public health with that, or they weren't interested in having us change it, nor do you see it effective. We're doing a lot of proactive work with Sergeant Andy Galley, and doing other background work that I think would be more effective. Tapping that issue.
May I make a comment? I'd like to know, how much of a problem it is. I don't like solutions for a problem that's not there. I remember your concern about this, and I didn't comment too much about it because you covered it earlier, and I felt that was sufficient. But when we got all the emails from the public, that they were just so glad that we jumped in there. I think it's a lot more pervasive than the issue. It just got a lot of public response. So I'd like to know from the chief, how much of an issue this really is, and if it is an issue that, he feels is out there and public commercial vendors of flavored cigarettes are not really taking the law, they're not paying attention to the law, maybe we should have a higher fine.
Chief, just before you chime in, I think it would be really great to hear about sort of the level of compliance that we see.
Right.
But I was just going to remind everybody that with the tobacco retail license, violations of the code also can result in suspension of your retail license and even revocation of your retail license. So the fine is one small piece of the overall puzzle in the enforcement strategy. And with that, Chief, I welcome your input and hear about the level of compliance that you see in the community.
Thank you for the question, members. Thank you for the opportunity to share some specifics. But City Manager Goldstein is right. The escalating penalties related to the license is really the deterrent for the purposes of what Councilmember Bertrand is talking about, violations of this ordinance. And then for Mayor Brooks, you're exactly right. The early conversation with the county group that was kind of driving each of the cities, not driving, but supporting each of the cities and going forward with these ordinances that our city thankfully fully supported. There was a significant effort to have some consistency region-wide, county-wide with regard to fine structuring. So that's why we started with the $100 fine for a violation. To answer your other question, currently we have a high level of compliance with our retailers with regard to this concern and these types of violations. Now, our hope is that we continue with that high level of compliance, and I think the grant monies that we have in place are going to give us the opportunity to ensure that we are holding the retail outlets accountable, sustaining the high level of compliance, all with the goal of protecting our youth. And so we're very pleased with where it is right now. Early on, I guess it was about a year and a half ago that then Councilmember Brooks made the request to agendize this item. And we're doing really well, but we need the support with resources, grant funding, and things we have in place now to ensure that we have that level of compliance. Thanks for the question.
Mayor, if I may follow up, how do we know that there's a high level of compliance? How do we determine that?
Yes, twofold. We monitor the number of complaints, and I don't know that number is zero, but it's probably pretty close to zero. And then we proactively do inspections, both the overt inspections, which are the most productive. That's where, you know, a uniformed officer will visit these. Back then, I think it was 16 or so establishments that were pretty proactive in making visits in there to make sure that they are adhering to the local ordinance. And then we respond to complaints, but we have not had any complaints, to my knowledge.
Thank you.
And the other, if I might add as well, the other piece of it coming forward is this outreach that we're going to engage in with the schools and with the youth directly. And so a combination of all those collaborative efforts is going to keep us on track with making sure we don't have violations and we're educating.
Yeah, I volunteered to be part of the outreach thing too. Unfortunately, I was on vacation when, you know, the captain set that meeting, but I'll be going to the rest of the meeting. So I think that's going to be a great program.
Okay, so any other comments? And remind me, we did go to public comment on this, right, Chloe?
Correct.
Okay. All right, so we're back. Would anyone like to entertain a motion?
I move to adopt the proposed resolution repealing resolution number 4149 and adopt the new bail schedule.
Okay, we have a first from Councilmember Bertrand. Do we have a second?
I can second that.
Okay, we have a second from Councilmember Kaiser. May I have a roll call, please?
Councilmember Bertrand.
I approve.
Councilmember Kaiser.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story.
Aye.
And Mayor Brooks.
Aye.
Okay, we're going to move on to item 8G. This is the designation of the voting delegate and alternate for the 2021 League of California Cities Annual Conference.
Thank you. I'll be presenting that very briefly as well. So give me 1 second again. I should say multiple seconds. Okay, and how about that, okay? Okay, great, thank you. So I'm sure you're all familiar at this point, but it is becoming time to have yourselves nominate someone to be the voting delegate at the League of Cities Annual Conference and Expo, if you wish. The conference is set to be done in person on September 22nd through 24th in Sacramento. And basically we need to know who is gonna be the voting delegate, if there will be one, before September so that everything can get set up. And the conference fee for all 3 days is $600. A one-day fee is $325. That would be the person just going for the voting only. That doesn't include lodging, of course. And just a quick overview of the budget scenario here. In this annually, in this full year, 2021-22, the council training budget is $2,500, which is $500 each. And typically, though there's been more for each of you, there has been a no-sharing agreement about the funds. So in this case, to attend the conference, there would be some sharing required and necessary, which we'd recommend just for this instance, not necessarily moving forward. So I just wanted to lay that all out for the council. And then really the action would be to designate a voting delegate if you'd like, and if you need an alternate. So you can discuss that amongst yourselves. Thank you.
Any questions on council? We'll move this to public comment. This is time to make a public comment. You can email publiccomment@ci.capitola.ca.us. Or if you'd like to speak, you can click on reactions below. Or if you called in today, you can dial *9 and our moderator will choose you. We have 3 minutes to speak.
Mayor Brooks, I do not see any attendees with their hands raised to speak on this item, and I do not see any email on this item.
Okay, so let's bring this back to council. Who would like to go?
I volunteered to be an alternate last year. I'll be glad to volunteer to be an alternate this year as well. Now that it's in Sacramento, I'm more inclined to go the virtual one, the truth.
Would you be interested in being the voting delegate, Councilmember Bertrand?
Well, I left that up to you, because last year I think you were the voting delegate, so that just the mayor should get the first choice.
I'm happy to pass it on.
Yeah, if someone else is inclined, yeah, that's fine.
Okay. We're lucky to have you, Councilmember Bertrand. Anyone else interested in being the alternate?
I can be the alternate.
Okay, Councilmember Kaiser. So we have our voting delegate. So would someone like to make a motion?
Before you make the motion, it might be helpful to get clarification that we're all on the same page about the budget situation, that for our alternate and our prime member, that there would be, they could exceed their $500 for travel. That would be helpful for staff to understand what the council is about on that. Oh, or if they need to travel within the $500.
I have one other question. So Jamie, it's a question for you and Margo too, I suppose, because we can borrow a city car to do the transport?
Yes, a city vehicle can be used for official city business.
Okay, great. So, Margo, if you're going, you know, we can both share the same car. And so I just want to get that straight, too. You don't want me to use my truck to go that far, believe me.
Okay, Council, we have a voting delegate and an alternate. Are we comfortable with using our funds to offset these costs for this one time? If everyone's in agreement, if someone would like to make a motion with those three items.
Yeah, if I may, I'll make a motion that Councilman Bertrand will be our voting delegate, and Councilman Kaiser will be his alternate, and that they should be fully reimbursed for any out-of-pocket expenses for attending the League of Cities.
We have a motion on the table. Chloe, you got that?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, great. And do we have a second?
I second it.
So the second from Councilmember Kaiser. May I have a roll call, please?
Yes. Councilmember Bertrand.
I agree.
Councilmember Kaiser.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story.
Aye.
Mayor Brooks.
Aye. So this item passes. On to item 9, adjournment. So, thank you, council, staff, and participants for being here tonight. Please remember to find the good in others and yourselves. Remember to wear your mask out and follow all CDC guidelines as they change on a daily basis. I appreciate all of you. Good night.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night.
Goodbye.